history, as you say, all of you have heard that history is written by the winners, right? And since there are so many things happening and so many things have happened in the past, what you get told is a selection. Essentially, it has to be a selection. So who selects and for what reason creates our perception of history and creates our perception of our past, who did what and what were the mentioned in our history textbooks. So what we are hoping to discuss today, because all our panelists have essentially written, as you heard in the introduction, all our panelists have written about people who are often neglected by history. You know, we find there has been a bias in selection when we write about history. So I think I'm going to ask the panelists to talk about this first. And I'm going to address a question, and then maybe all of the panelists can answer this. Who are the people who had important roles to play, who influenced our present and who created, but who are typically neglected by most history books? Jahnavi?
Thanks, Archana. I think logically, the first thing I would say is women. Women across various social strata, economic strata, different kinds of education, don't really find a mention in our fiction. And I, for one, and all of us, I know, naturally write what we know best. So I write women and what people sometimes call domestic fiction, you know, kitchen sink fiction. But we write what we know best. And I'm glad there's so many women writers today, because women are being written about. That's the first category. And the second, I come from the Northeast. And I find in Indian writing, be it nonfiction, especially nonfiction, I think, and because fiction is coming out in a big way, and in fiction, there's very little about the Northeast. It still remains an unknown. It still remains behind the veil. And again, unconsciously, because I am from there, I write what I know best, I write about the Northeast. So these two areas for me stand out as in being a little bit neglected in fiction and nonfiction.
Reema?
Yeah, so good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for inviting me for the panel. So as you, Jahnavi, said, like, women are one of the areas that, again, we being women, and we tend to write and focus more on the women, because there was actually a very interesting, there was this Nation Builders of India. They were, Tata Tiscon had come out with a note about the Nation Builders of India, and they'd highlighted six nation builders. And these are forgotten heroes. They were trying to highlight forgotten heroes. But guess what? All six of them were men. And so that kind of prompted us when we started our book about Dot that went for a walk, is to saying, hey, cannot be. We are 50% of the population. Don't tell me there's not a single nation builder among these men that you've highlighted. And so that actually, and so when we started looking, you know, we found these amazing stories, and it's not that these stories don't exist. They just have not been told enough. And I think today's conversation is about changing that narrative and is about talking about women and the accomplishments, celebrating. The other area that I'm very passionate about is about inclusion. And when we talk about inclusion, we talk about, so I'm a mother of a child who has severe disabilities. And this is something, another thing that in our Indian context, we actually overlook completely. It's like this segment of population doesn't exist. And I strongly believe and very passionate about inclusion. And I think we need to start with literature as, I believe, one area where we can start building that inclusive society. So those are my two areas that I'll talk further about.
I'd just like to illustrate here. You know, when you talk about people with disabilities, and we don't really talk about them in our history. So I've written a book, The Women Who Ruled India, about 20 women rulers. One of them was Didda, who was the queen of Kashmir in the 10th century. And she was so disabled that she couldn't walk. So she used to be carried around by this woman called Valga in a basket. I don't know how she was carried around exactly. But she was a very, very able, very shrewd, and very tough, and very nasty ruler. But she managed to control Kashmir for 50 years. She's also I mean, it's not to say that's a thing one should do, but she would also take part in races where Valga had to run carrying her, and she'd win all the races because who's going to beat the queen?
I know, just to add to that, we do have a new role models, right? So how many of you watch badminton or are familiar with that? And there is a recent person, would anyone like to say the name? Mansi, right? She's recently won a gold medal, and I think it's phenomenal thanks to Pulela and the team that have really worked with her to enable her. So she has a leg that's a bionic leg as well as an arm. She has a rod inserted in her arm, and she has won a badminton championship. So okay. Yes.
Before I go to Priya, just one more question. Does any of you know there was a Mughal emperor who was dyslexic?
Akbar,
right?
So I think a lot of you have covered many of the points that I would have mentioned as well. So like coming to the Northeast, now I do a lot of picture books something that I notice is that, you know, whenever it's a story about the Northeast, it's always a folk tale. You know, there are lives of people beyond folk tales. There are lived realities that, you know, never... people living, you know, normal lives in the Northeast, which never kind of get mentioned in books. About women, of course, it's always been a very conscious effort to have not recorded women's histories. In fact, there are Mughal paintings where you can actually see certain Mughal paintings where there were these very powerful queens which were actually blackened out. The face of the queens were later blackened out so that... this conscious erasure is another thing, so it's not something to be taken very lightly. It's also about looking at the same person in different ways. So I worked an author on the life on a graphic novel on Indira Gandhi, and the thing is, her life has been recorded I think there are already 10 biographies about her life, but we wanted to make, you know, something that was accessible to young adults. Now, when we learned about our leaders in Amar Chitra, you know, it was mostly through Amar Chitra Kathas and textbooks. So they all offer you a very hagiographical account where, you know, there's this great person and she did these great things. There's also the, these leaders were actually humans like you and me. So we tried to sort of include things from her life, which we found very interesting, that, you know, she was somebody who suffered from depression or as a teenager, the way she, you know, met her husband in very unusual circumstances. So these are things that I think a teenager would... it is history, but at the same time, it is history that is made relevant to personal lives of teenagers. So I think historical fiction is also something that one can, you know, have more of, because it gives you context to certain historical times.
No, I absolutely agree with you, Priya. I mean, non-fiction is interesting, and if it's interestingly told, but it's the story. Yes. At the end of the day, it's the story that remains with you. Here, I'd just like to take a little diversion. Now, women, there were very few, a very small percentage were, and even that percentage, we don't talk about those people. Just as an interesting thing, all of you are here, have you ever wondered, if you do today, you do IQ tests, if you see in your schools when the women are writing the exams and all of that, women do equally well, is it right? Am I right or am I wrong? Better, equal, whatever, not worse. Right? Then why is it? Have you ever thought, why is it that women were not as prominent in you know, in the public life or in power. They did not share that kind of power. And why is it that we are talking, now today everybody talks about it, the percentage of women in every profession is increasing. It's not where it ought to be maybe, but it's continuously increasing. What has happened? What has happened in the last 50, 70, 100 years that we are talking about it?
Required to prove yourself more available to women also, because you know the thing is, because of technological advancement, what happens is brain gets more importance rather than, you know, carrying heavy loads or fighting with great masculine strength. That importance has reduced.
No, I agree with you absolutely. Yeah. In terms of physical work, muscle use.
Yeah, yeah.
Muscle women are use. Still using a lot of the muscle. But here I'd like to share with you something from evolutionary biology. Please. I'd like to share with you something from evolutionary biology. In most mammals, the males are heavier than the females, which is a measure of strength. You can say it's, the term used is sexual dimorphism, because the two genders are different weights. And they have done a study. Now, most male mammals have harems. So to say, they have more than one female consort. And there is almost a correlation. You've studied maths. There is a correlation between the difference in weight and the size of harem. So if the two animals are similar in size, if the male and female are similar in size, the animal may be monogamous, I think, like gorillas. If there is a wide difference, like in the elephant seal, where the male is about four times the weight of the female, this weight would be a measure of power. Harems could be about 80, the size of 80 females. So this clearly indicates that this difference between male and female was to do with physical strength. And as times have come about, with the rule of law, physical strength is not what determines what happens. But the major reason why I think women, we are talking about them, because you've had rule of law in previous centuries, right, where people are not necessarily kidnapped and forced to do things, is contraception. Yes, they were always pregnant or lactating. And again, if you see, I mean, we now talk about menstruation publicly. An average woman has 400 menstrual cycles in her life. It's a very wasteful exercise. And when people questioned, scientists started examining why would such a wasteful thing be selected in an evolutionary perspective. They said, if you look at the data from ancient times, a woman only on an average had 40 cycles in her life because she was either pregnant or feeding. So if till the age of 45 you are out of commission, so to say, then how are you going to get out and achieve anything in a professional kind of sphere? And I think since contraception's getting generally popular over the last 50, 70 years, I think that has a major role to play in women in public life. Just a thought, think about it. So this is something about the women power relationship. Let me, picking on from what Priya has said, that the other part of stories which are not told, I mean, like they said, women, Northeast, I think tribals, Dalits, these are all farmers, farmers movements, these are all neglected. But even of the people about whom we hear stories, if we have designated a person as good, we will only hear the good things they did. We will not hear things which would be considered bad in today's world. Or if we've designated a person as bad, we will not hear about the good things they did. We'll only hear about the bad things they did. What is that aspect of history? And what do you think, you know, can you illustrate it with some examples? And what do you think ought to be done about that?
That happens frequently. And I think the first thing top of head comes to my mind is Ravana. For us, you know, when you look at nationalities, I mean, from what was India then, whatever it was called then, Bharat, for us, he was not a good guy, right? Because he was the anti-hero for us. But where he came from, in Sri Lanka, he is revered as almost a god. And he was apparently, he had many good qualities. It's that his interests were in conflict with ours. So perspective, sometimes we need to look at things in two ways. There was a book, I can't remember, I don't know if you'll remember, about...
some historical fiction with Ravan as the
hero.
And I think even in Valmiki Ramayana and all, he's supposed to be a great scholar.
Yes.
And Ram takes, you know, when Ravan is lying on his deathbed, Lakshman goes to take rulership lessons from.
Exactly. So many good
Ravan.
Qualities which we don't hear about that often. Yes.
So I wanted to bring two perspectives. One is that you know, have you heard of unconscious bias? Right? So there's one thing is that conscious bias that we all have, maybe because of our experiences and so on and so forth. But there's a very, a topic called unconscious bias, where the idea is that we are not even aware that we have these biases, but they are there in our system. And it's because of the stories maybe we have brought up with. And a lot of times you hear this is translated as stereotypes, right? Where you say, hey, people from the Northeast are of a certain, you bucket them in a certain bracket. There would be people, women, you bracket them as something separate. And the whole idea between with unconscious bias is to become aware. And what stereotypes does is it makes us aware of what is. Because stereotypes are formed, basically you might see a certain trend, right? They say girls don't do well on math, because if you look at SAT scores, and actually in the US this has been done, that last 10 years, and actually Larry Summers of Harvard University made a statement that women are not capable of doing math at a certain level. And they showed that through SAT scores, there was 10:1 difference ratio average across men's boys' scores and women's scores. But when you looked at it across 10 years, you found that the scores actually had come down to a ratio of 2:1. So imagine going from 10:1 difference to 2:1, and then how can you say it's genetic, right? Or is something that it's ingrained in women? So this is one of the things that we bring out through unconscious biases, is to really understand what are we associating with. And generally, as you rightly said, maybe in previous times, we associated, because women were the nurturers and the caregivers and were taking the next generation forward, their primary role was to nurture the child, to be at home, and now that role has changed. And the whole idea with being aware of our unconscious bias is that we need to make sure that as is doesn't become it ought to be. Very, very different, right? As is, what we see today doesn't necessarily mean what it ought to be 10 years down the road. And I think that's about changing the narrative with changing times and making sure we build that narrative. And I feel authors play an amazing role in that area, because we kind of visualize, we can use the power of imagination to think about what it ought to be and not limit ourselves to what is. And that's the point I wanted.
Historical figures, they took decisions in a certain context. Would they take the same decision now? No. I mean, or maybe yes. So these were just people who were doing things, they were reacting to things that were happening around themselves at that particular point of time. So it's always important to kind of see that particular figure in respect to what was happening around them. They were not operating in a vacuum. So I think it's important to kind of stress on that when you say write about man, woman, and also every generation kind of rewrites history in a certain way, like with the consciousness that we have now. Now we look at, you know, everything under the lens of gender, caste. So there is a certain consciousness. So I think that's something that sort of happens over a period of time. So I think this whole black and white kind of narrative that especially used to exist, you know, in our textbooks and things, it was just lazy history. There was more, you know, so you can't afford to be a lazy historian, I think.
I think besides a lazy history, I think quite often, and to act, you know, to set up these role models who you should be emulating, and whoever are the heroes of that time, or, you know, whatever things you value, whatever, you know, characteristics you value, you imbue or you select. You select somebody or you imbue them with those characteristics and you tell the children, look, there was this great man who was your ancestor or who belonged to this space, and look at all the good things you did, he did, and you should also be doing these good things. And they won't talk about how he used to beat his wife or whatever he did, and, you know, because they to take away from the moral teaching aspect of his character. But I think we are getting more mature now. I think we can I just have this simple thing. You have family members who you're still affectionate about and who you like, who, you know, there may be certain things about theirs you don't like at all. But you still maintain your neighbors, you still maintain those relationships. I think we need to have a similar relationship even with our characters from our history. And in any case, truth, Satyamev Jayate, truth is important, even if it takes away. Even if it takes away from the moral and the teaching aspect, I think we should not fool ourselves, because the thing about truth is it will always emerge. It will come out. So you may as well be prepared for it in the, you know, right at the beginning, without it shattering you and pushing you over the edge. So I was just thinking, how about if you can each name a person whose story has been neglected and you think should be there in our books, and a person whose story has been misrepresented in terms of only a particular aspect has been shown and you think other aspects, or they could be controversial figures from today, this thing. So can I start with you, Priya?
I've actually been
for both the things.
I've been very hung up. So I've been just curious about that. I mean, we've been again told about his life in a particular way, and I might have my biases. So I mean, I think it's also important to kind of read people you might not really agree with, or if you ask me, I'm currently planning to read up on that.
So you think Savarkar is somebody who was not there in our history books, and look at him?
I'm not saying that we should. I haven't come to that conclusion as yet. But I'm just saying I'm curious about it. And I think there were, like, recently we were researching about something, and there were, in the freedom movement, I read that there were other revolts apart from, you know, the 1957 revolt, which apparently have not really been written about. So, you know, these smaller stories of other revolts that happened.
One revolt I can talk about, I mean, of course, Tipu Sultan used to be, we were truly scared of him because he'd got technology, he had collaborated with the French, and when you read the British writings in that period, among the Indian rulers, he was the one who really, you know, they were afraid of him. But in my book, Women Who Ruled India, I have talked about Velu Nachiyar, who was a Tamil female ruler. And there is this Poligar revolt, which happened in 1800, which is like a precursor to the 1857. I'm just thinking, because you talked about that. And that has happened in this region, and it lasted for quite a long time. And it was almost like, it was like a precursor to 1857, the things that the Indians did, the things that the British did, and how it happened. So this may be interesting for you to look at as almost local history. How the Mysore, and what were the things, why was Hyder Ali so successful against the British when the other rulers weren't? You know, we're not talking, as I said, there were some good things Tipu did, there were some bad things he did. But he was quite effective. Hyder Ali was tremendously effective against the British. Tipu, not so much, because he probably didn't have the judgment of his father, and probably British technology was improving faster than he could capture and emulate. But this is something as an exercise which might be interesting for you to investigate the local history, both the Poligar Wars and Poligar is what the British called it. We should be saying Palayakkar, but that is the Devika.
I was going to pick one. My favorite is Kamla Devi Chattopadhyay.
Oh, yes.
So she's a woman which is phenomenal. I think she's the first feminist in the modern right jargon of feminism. And you won't believe, this is in 1930s, 40s, right? So imagine she got married when she was a child, about 12 years of age. She was a child bride. Then she sadly, the person passed away, so she got widowed. And in those days, widows were supposed to, as you know, be just within the house and do housework. And she said, no, I'm going to study further. She pursued her studies. And then actually, so in those days also widows were not supposed to marry, right? And she met Sarojini Naidu's brother and she actually married him. And she said, nope, I have my own life. She asserted herself. She said, nope, I think this is best for me. And not only that, she actually got a divorce later on as well. So, I mean, it's just amazing to me that she has followed, she has made her choices. It's about making choices. For me, it was very interesting that in that age when everything was a taboo and tradition, it was wrapped under the garb of tradition, there's someone who stood out and said, no, this is not a choice that I agree with. I would like to make a different choice. And she asserted herself. And this is just part of her personal life that she has done in that. But just look at it from her own professional life. She was actually the founder of the Arts and Crafts Council of India. So all the heritage, right, that we preserve about our tribal art, our artisans, thanks to her, they were made visible to a much larger national level platform. She was also the woman who founded the Lady Sri Ram College. So Miranda College, I think, Miranda. So, but phenomenal accomplishment. She, you know, she had a personal life and she had her own professional life and she managed both. She made her choices and she was very proud of it. So that's one story that I believe a lot of our kids need to hear and learn about it. Funnily enough, we discovered her only during our research of the book. So we have not heard of her, although she's such an accomplished person.
I'm from Delhi, right? So she, cottage industries and all of that. I mentioned her in my book on History of India for Children. Sure. Very few people have heard of her. Rukaiya Sakhawat Hussain. She was a Bengali zamindar's daughter in the late 1800s. And she was not lettered. And then she got married and her husband encouraged her to read and write English. And she wrote very revolutionary feminist works. She set up schools for girls. And her thinking was like, you know, like Brahmos used to encourage women's education. And they say, why do we encourage education? So that they are Sakhi, Sumata, Sugrihini. Means they will be a better companion, they will be a better mother, and they will be a better housekeeper. You know, look after the house better, which is why women's education is important. Which a lot of the Brahmo people who supported education, you know, the Bengali intellectuals, the Tagore family, Keshav Chandra Sen and all, that was the essential argument. She said that women's education is important for the women themselves. It is not there so that they can be better playing their subsidiary roles. And from one of her books, I'd just like to give a small excerpt. There is a line where somebody is talking to a person and he says, I say, astronomer sir, why is your wife measuring pillowcases when you are measuring the stars? So she had a totally different, there's a book of her, Sultana's Dream. It's very short. It's available online. You can just download it from anywhere. It's free to read. It's very interesting. She's envisaged a world where women are ruling rather than men. And it's a very interesting perspective to read.
Kamla Devi Chattopadhyay, The person she was married to who died was my grandfather-in-law's younger brother. This is a Brahmo family from Mangalore, and this is the Brahmo thread coming in. So she was a child bride, right? So I've grown up hearing this in family law after I've been married into this family. Very interesting. So she was a child bride, and then the husband to be died. And then the families got together, being Brahmo families, both her family and what I hear, our family, her to be in-laws, said, go ahead, remarry, study, and we are behind you. So this is within. When you talk about history, family history. This is the unconscious stereotype I've grown up with. So it's a great example to sort of live up to, you know. Talking about my personal, some one person I would like talked about. I think the whole of the Northeast, many people, there's so many characters there, and you've been there, you've written about women. Especially the status of women, generally in the Northeast, is so good. And there's so many powerful women you can write about from that area. Also a bit about the Ahom history. A lot of India does not know that Assam was ruled 800, 900 years continuous. I think one of the longest dynastic unbroken rules in the subcontinent were the Tai Shans, who came from Shan state, originally the Dais from southern China, and who crossed the Patkai hills, demolished all the tribes, Nagas, etc. in the way, and came to Assam. They were Buddhists, but they had the foresight when they came into Assam to embrace Hinduism, particularly Shakti Hinduism. They realize if they have to stay, they can't be the other. They have to become the main pillar. So they married into Hindu families. They converted to Shakti Hinduism. They built a whole lot of peace, very powerful Shiva temples, Shakti temples they built and supported. And they became part of the fabric, as it were, and which enabled them to rule unbroken. They had very interesting systems. Rice cultivation, which spread through the rest of India, came from the Thais. Very organized governance, as in, I hear, this is rumor, I don't know if history supports it, historians can tell us, when you enter their state of what was Assam then, what they called their land, they called it the Golden Land, something like Suvarna Bhumi in Thai. I believe you were given a sort of a document like a visa, which you carry through with you, and when you left, you would relinquish it. They're very organized governance, which very disciplined sort of Far East kind of philosophies. So a little bit more about various personalities from that region I'd love to see in Indian texts.
At least we have one Lachit Barfukan.
I think the Ahoms defeated the Mughals 17 times.
But I'm saying this...
One person,
he's one person. You see, most of the other heroes we talk about, I'm sorry to say, are people who lost to Mughals, but we want to make them heroes because they resisted. This guy resisted and actually defeated them, and to the extent that the Mughals never ventured to Assam again.
They never took over
Assam. It was such a bad defeat.
They never
gave up the whole idea. So that's another hero
we need to talk about.
Right. So I think we are coming to the end of our time. I'd just like briefly for each panelist, just one thing and then we'll open it. One recommendation you would have so that, you know, for the, you know, what each person, the children and the parents sitting here can do to engage more, you know, something they should read or what should they do?
Fabulous books. It's set in the Northeast. It's historical fiction, but it tells you a lot about, you know, it's set during World War II. Then Devika Rangachari has written this book called Queen of Ice, which
Didda.
Is about Didda. So since you mentioned Didda, I think you should pick up that book. It's beautifully
written.
You
can mention your own book also.
Also my book. I've written a graphic...
Book on?
Yeah, a book on... I've illustrated a novel, a graphic novel, along with an author, Dev Priya Roy. It's on the life of Indira Gandhi. It's for young adults.
Through, but I think definitely our book is one thing that I would recommend. You know, it's The Dot That Went for a Walk. It's about 51 inspirational women from India. The other thing that, you know, I would like to recommend is a lot of science fiction. I think, we grew up reading a lot of science fiction. I think one of the themes of this event is about future, it's about identity, it's about future. And I think given that you are the next generation and you will be coming across a lot of technology, maybe it's a general recommendation, right, is that we will have a lot of things that we are not even aware are propelling us in a certain direction. So I don't know how many of you have used mobile phones, right, and a lot of recommendations come for you that, and I think especially as kids, as you interact on social media, as you interact on various platforms, I think book is great because there's a little bit of a difference versus in media, when you especially talk about digital media, there's a lot of things that are happening at the back end that you might not even be aware. So you're getting recommendations, even though you do not know, and it's based on your past pattern, and suddenly you find that you're boxed in with the same kind of thinking, because that's what digital media will expose you to. So I would really ask you to be a little bit critical and analytical and diversify, right? So sometimes you tend to read the same things, and maybe with digital, just be a little bit more, not suspicious, but critical would be, I would say, look at everything, question it, saying, is this really me? Is this really what I believe? And, you know, try to look for answers or different perspectives.
India particularly, before you venture into the wider world, we grew up reading a lot of the Katha books. I don't know if you've read the Katha series, in which we could read fiction in translation, very good translations, and it takes you out of your own box, as Reema said. For example, living in Delhi, I could read about a South Indian lady in Chennai, or about something happening in Gujarat. You know, and it's always different reading non-fiction. You can read history, geography, and economics, but what fiction gives you is an insight into the soul of a community. So read fiction in translation, short stories particularly, if you don't have the patience to go through novels. Also now there's a lot of English coming out of various regions of India. We keep saying Northeast, there's a huge bunch of writers from the Northeast. In fact, Penguin has a series called Jewels of the Northeast in English, so it's easy for you to read. Similarly, you know, every region has its own English and its own philosophies. Books from Bangalore are very different from books from Bombay. Try and discern that difference, try and delve into different regions of India. You'll see differences which you can celebrate, you'll see a lot of commonalities which you can celebrate. And if you do this growing up, it's nothing like it at that age.
So even in the general history book, I've tried to talk about, you know, women rulers and people who are normally not mentioned. Besides that, for me, I always made it a point to try, if I would travel, I would try to pick up books from that region, and I would also not only read in English, but say Hindi, you know, if I went to, I read Hindi, so I would pick up, if I'd go to a temple, for example, there's always a shop outside which is selling all those little religious cheap looking books. I would go to the shop and they're very reasonable, right? I would pick up every book, I didn't. Pick up each and every of those things. It wouldn't cost a lot. But those stories you would not encounter in English. They may not be, I mean, you know, they may have their biases, they may be not very interesting, but you would get a totally different perspective. You would get to know about local heroes, even if it's a badly written book in English. That, you know, when you, or if I go to any other country, I just went, you know, even in Singapore, I went, I picked up a lot of Chinese comics in bad English translations. But it was really interesting for me because you get a perspective into their minds. And I can tell you, just closing this one little story, I'd gone to one temple, somehow a lot of steps, you know, in Uttarakhand, I went up also. There was this book I picked up of local folk stories. In that, there was a story about a queen who had trapped 30,000 Mughal soldiers, Queen of Garhwal, Karnavati, Queen of Garhwal. She trapped 30,000 Mughal soldiers who had attacked, and then she, so they asked for terms because they were starving, and she was not a nice queen or whatever. She cut off their noses, 30,000 noses, and sent the troops back to Delhi. Now, I'd never come across this story, right, in my normal textbooks, and then I researched it, and she's very well talked about by many Mughal writers and by foreign travelers, Bernier, Tavernier, they've all mentioned her. And Shahjahan used to call her Nakati Rani because she Nakatwadi uski. But so I'm saying, you come across these stories, which is not to say that it's a good thing to cut off noses, just to, but you come across these stories which you wouldn't otherwise. And since we are lucky enough that we speak more than one language, all of us, you know, you'll be people here would be speaking Kannada, Hindi. Please go out and read that regional literature. You will get things you will not get anywhere, you know, in English necessarily. Okay, I think we are almost out of time. Any questions?
Women in India should simply not have the option to stay at home and take care of the house, and that's preventing them.
Dhruv, no, I don't think that. I don't think anything should be made mandatory or must do or must be. In that case, maybe if the man stays at home, the woman can go out and do something. It should be a balance. It should be equally shared.
Can I also say something technically? You see, if you see the Scandinavian countries, maybe 80% of the women are part of the workforce. I mean, they have formal paid jobs and they go out. And the reason, I've been working in the gender field, I had invited the ambassadors of these countries to talk about what were the policy changes or what were the policy support that the governments were giving to enable these women to work. Because I'm from IIM Ahmedabad, I did a study of various batches, and 50% of the women who are, you know, batchmates of my sister or my batchmates are not working. And there's a single reason, because they took a long break to be with their children. And then after that, it became very difficult to get back into a senior post in their work life. So these are problems which are faced all over the world. So how is it that 80% of the women out there are working? And so the Iceland ambassador, which is generally rated number one on the gender parity index in the world, he said that in the 70s, they took a step to lengthen school hours. In India, schools finish at about 1:30, 2 o'clock, right? He said that they lengthened the school hours to about 4:30. There was a lot of resistance. People said, you know, institutional, bachche ho jayenge, family life will be destroyed, etc. But what it did is it created an 8 to 4, 8 hours of guilt-free working time for women. And that is, he says, that is what tipped it over in our country. So it's often not about, if you ask a woman, you know, your children are going to be at home alone and you go to work and all of that, it's an emotional decision, and people say my children are more important than any extra money I could earn. But if you create an institutional structure where the children are well taken care of, even today the children come home and they're sent to classes. It's not that the mother is, you know, tennis ja rahe, chess ja rahe. Not the mother is sitting and holding their hand. She's just coordinating. So if you create a system where all this happens in school, which many countries have done, then you can have a situation where, you know, neither the men nor the women have to stay home, and then they can have their good time with their children later.
Can I just add to that? Because I feel very strongly about this. This has happened to me personally, what she said about what you mentioned about I'm Ahmedabad, half the women drop out because they have to take care of the families. So by profession, I'm actually a secret medical doctor. I'm a pathologist. I gave up, I took that short break, maternity for my child, and then it's difficult to get back. And then I became a writer, which I enjoy very much. But to go to one of your earlier questions, Archana, why are women more prominent in the last 50 years, 40 years, 30 years, 20 years than they were before? I didn't say anything then, but this is one reason, that we have better structures now which enable women to get out there and do what they have to do. And on the Scandinavian front, again, a personal experience. My sister lives in Norway. She's an economics professional, social development professional. And what they've done here, apart from adjusting school hours, is they have a year of maternity leave, they have a year of paternity leave. So then the next year, the man stays at home. So the first 2 years are taken care of. And beyond that, the creche system is so good. Nurses come home, doctors come home, you leave your child in safe hands. Is that almost nobody drops out of work.
At least make it easy for schools, incentivize them to stay open till 4:30, maybe have extra classes in school itself, and you'll see. It'll become much easier for women.
And I would not want to lose the point that also part of it is that you know, making sure that it's not the, like, there's a very nice cartoon about cognitive load, right?
Yes.
And so women have doubled the cognitive load because not only are we working, but we are also worrying about some of the things that's happening at home. And if we can share the cognitive load with our counterpart, it really helps lessen the load and we can equally excel in anything and everything.
Residual responsibilities, you know, even women who are working, they have to keep planning sabzi aayi ki nahi, whatever planning that goes on at home.
Absolutely.
It's invisible work, basically.
Yes. Okay, any more questions?
This is one question I've noticed. And so before I moved into a new school, a lot of history textbooks that talked about castes did talk about caste discrimination. But the only main idea I got, that the most basic idea, was that Shudras are right, Brahmins are wrong. So the way that a lot of people who talk about history phrase their opinions is that someone's right, someone's wrong. And fact is never actually given out. And even if you're talking for someone who has been subjected to sheer torture, it's highlighting them as almost gods. Like, so for instance, one of the shortlisted books named Ahimsa, there's a beautiful passage where it mentions that someone asked whether Gandhiji was right in calling Dalits god-like people. And it asks that it's all about being equal. It's not about presenting someone as God. So I just want to ask, how do you feel about this?
People of God, which all of us are. So the meaning is, no, it's slightly different because, you know, the interpretation becomes different. Would anybody like to take this?
Yeah, again, I would say, you know, context, certain, you know, period of time. So it's important to understand that he recognized that at a certain point of time. He was not correct about a lot of things. So it's only when you sort of, that's why I think you need to, it's important that you read beyond textbooks because it is from, you know, outside of textbooks through books that you kind of get multiple perspectives about the same man. And you'll realize that Gandhi was a very, very complicated person. So there'll be somebody who would have, you know, written about Gandhi's personal life. So was he again, he had a very, you know, complicated relationship with his wife. So was he anti-women? Was he, so I think it's important to kind of read multiple perspectives of the same these icons that are sort of worshipped. It's always important to read multiple perspectives and understand them in a nuanced way. And there are no black and white answers to a question like that.
Okay, so there is one of his very famous book called, not a book, but a write-up called Snitches. Have you heard of this character called Snitches?
I've read this a lot of times.
And what do you like about Snitches?
I mean, both of them wanted to gain over and then, I mean, it was just ended up as a cycle and repeated the oppressor, so, oppressed.
Right. Excellent. So just for those of you who do not know, this is a very powerful social concept, right, of homophily. Like we tend to be around people who look like us and who are like us. And this was and the whole idea is that we want to now, you know, open up our mind and perspectives. And Snitches is this where he has two, there's a character called Snitches in Dr. Seuss' book. One of them have a little star around their belly button and the other Snitches don't have that star. So the people who have the stars think they are specially endowed. And so they think that the people who don't have the stars are not endowed and so they look down upon them. So out comes a business guy who says, hey, people who don't have stars, I can give you stars. And I'll charge you something for it. So all the people who are snitches, who don't have stars, saying, hey, this is great, right? So they all go and give them the money, and he gets them a star. And suddenly the snitches, they find there's a lot of snitches now with stars, and they say, hey, we want to be, you know, all snitches have stars, so we are not differentiated. So then this same, the business guy says, hey, you know what, I can remove the star from you. And so the snitches go to him and saying, hey, can you remove the star from me because we want to be special. And so the whole cycle continues till all the snitches run out of money and the business guy goes back happy. And snitches suddenly realize, hey, it doesn't matter whether we have a star or not, we are all the same. So very powerful story told through Dr. Seuss.
And another thing I want to, you know, your special thing about Brahmins and Shudras. You see, if you have any group of people, human beings being what they are, will exploit, suppress people who are not in power. And if, say, any other group which was originally not in power comes into power, they will also do the same. It's very harsh. You know people, suppose you have monitors in school. Some will exploit it and some will not. But people who are not monitors cannot exploit it because they don't have any potential. With you were in power, you used that power or you didn't. You were not in power, you didn't behave badly because you had no opportunity to behave badly. And now you get in power, you may behave equally badly.
You can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the caste system was occupational in the beginning to do the profession and it was flexible.
Up from around 1000 BC to about zero, you had genetic mingling.
And you could move castes, you could move professions.
Yeah, there was flexibility, but it's sort of frozen since the last 2000 years now genetically. An interesting book on that also. Priya, Reema, Jahnavi, and thank you, audience, and thank you, Neev.